So welcome back to the session. So we'll have our next speaker is Mr. Manish Gupta, who is the director of Google Research India, who is also a member of our advisory committee of Faisal Bhopal on data science and engineering. So he has been contributing in developing the data science program in Faisal Bhopal. So Manish.
Okay. Thank you. Okay, so I'll talk about accelerating applied sciences using machine learning. So I already covered most of the first part of the talk where I wanted to talk about why these times are special. Then I'll talk about, again, the basic idea of how you apply machine learning to accelerate science. What I'll do is I'll use three examples during my talk. The first one will be on predicting properties of molecules, which is important in a number of areas, including in particular drug design. I'll talk about flood prediction, some work that has been done on flood prediction. And finally, a little bit of combination of some work done already and the promise of transforming healthcare through a more proactive approach. And later on, you'll hear some words of some pravachan from Baba Manish. Well, I'll try to impart some pearls of wisdom. You can decide to discard them. I always say it's good to take it from one ear and take it out from the other. Okay, so I've already talked about this, that I feel we are in these very special times with this exponential doubling of compute power. And what that has led us to is these old ideas have come back in a very, very strong manner, right? So deep learning, as you all know, probably, is nothing but a reincarnation, modern day reincarnation of these artificial neural networks. And these are amazing. I mean, these are very simple mathematical units. All you're doing is you have some input, you're multiplying that input with some weight, you're adding some constant, take out the output, and you organize these very simple units in these layers. There are theoretical results that with a two-layer network, you can basically, I mean, if it is of arbitrary width, arbitrary number of units, you can actually approximate any computable function. And then when you organize these in the form of multiple layers, people have shown, for instance, all these different layers, people have shown, again, amazing things that can be done. I mean, it seems like magic that, yes, you are feeding it all this data corresponding to, let's say, pixels from an image of a cat. You are operating on all that pixel data. You're doing these simple mathematical operations, and once in a while, you do some maximum value of a certain number of units, and so on. And out comes this function. I mean, it is really more like a numerical function, right? Where you, if you have, let's say, 1,000 object categories, you're choosing the encoding of what you might consider a cat or a dog and so on. But it's pretty amazing that you come out then with this, all from very, very simple ideas based on optimization theory and calculus, right? I mean, so typically what you're doing is you have, some labeled data, you're trying to learn a predicted function which is close to the true function, and you refer to that difference as loss function, and then you're just like what you learned in high school, you're trying to take the derivative of that loss function with respect to all these weights, and you're trying to make it zero because that's the point at which you're trying to find that minimum. And again, if you apply chain rule of calculus, Jeff Hinton came up with this backpropagation method through which you are able to then learn the values of these weights and you learn these interesting functions. And what we have seen is some very interesting functions that the deep neural networks have been able to learn. I just talked about this. From the pixel, you can essentially recognize the main type of that object. So this is referred to as image classification. Given an audio signal, this audio signal you might recognize, oh, this is saying how cold is it outside, so referred to as speech to text or automatic speech recognition problem. Given this text, there are again neural models that might kind of, given this input, will give you this output, and you will recognize this is nothing but machine translation from English going to French. And now some fancier version of that image classification task, where given an image, now you can even come up with a description of that image similar to what a human might come up with. So these are the kind of amazing functions that the deep neural network is able to learn. And that has led to, again, many of these products, like Google Photos, was designed in a completely different manner, assuming that you would have this ability to recognize the type of the image automatically. So, but now here, given the topic of this conference, I'll focus my attention more on how now some of these same kind of techniques can be applied towards accelerating science. So the basic idea here is to help with that scientific discovery process. So, I mean, often scientists are analyzing huge volumes of data. So Professor Uma earlier was talking about this fourth paradigm, right? So, I mean, initially you used to have this experimentation, empirical observations, and theory as the two legs. That was the scientific discovery process when I was in school. Then came high performance computing, which is the kind of profession that I joined after my PhD, where we would often, when the real world experiments were too expensive or sometimes infeasible to do, you used numerical simulations based on laws of physics to simulate the world and again do the experiments, the equivalent of experiments using simulations. Now, we are seeing a similar phenomenon, just like sometimes you were doing all these simulations when the real world experiments were too expensive. Often what we find is simulations, if you really want to apply laws of physics at the right level of whatever granularity, again often it is too expensive to simply do those simulations. So one example, for instance, that I learned, I was meeting with some of these scientists and applied scientists, basic scientists and applied scientists at ICTS, International Center for Theoretical Sciences, which is at Bangalore. There were people who were doing the modeling of the Indian monsoon. And they told me, I mean, a few things that I didn't know about earlier. One is that if you just apply normal, conventional global climate models, they would not be able to explain the Indian monsoon. And second, what we all learned in our high school about why the monsoon forms and so on, that is just very highly oversimplified. Because again, yes, it is true to some degree. Yes, I mean, there's because of heat, there's evaporation that happens out of these, let's say, Bay of Bengal and so on. And you have those clouds forming and so on. But I mean, just that simplified version simply would not explain why monsoons behave the way they do. So if you really wanted to apply, again, the laws of physics to that whole evaporation phenomenon, how the clouds form and so on, the computational needs you would have are at least 10 to the power 13 higher than today's fastest supercomputers. So as a result, they say we have to take shortcuts. We have to create abstractions and so on. And often what you find is you will find this a recurrent theme. Often now these machine learning people, they are applying these techniques from standard, like traditional machine learning, and now increasingly deep learning in combination with, or sometimes in lieu of, these numerical simulations. So I'll give you some examples. So I'll primarily be talking about this. What is, in my view, very, very important is also this. So while, in fact, the work that I will present today, and so far, a lot of the work that has happened has been in this category, where we look at how to apply machine learning to help with science. I personally believe it is extremely important for us in the machine learning world to also learn from what I consider the real scientists. I mean, I consider those of us who are computer scientists to be more like fake scientists. I mean, I consider the physicists, the biologists, and so on. And apologies if I offend any computer scientists here, but I really consider them to be the real scientists. So my view is we need to learn from the real scientists of how they do science. In particular, I mean, physicists, when they are observing all this data, they create much more compact models of the world, usually in the form of equations. It could be simple equations like Newton's laws of motion, or it could be a bit more complex equations like maybe Schrodinger's equations, but still, it's fairly compact representation. Whereas we in the machine learning world and in the deep learning world, we come up with very, very complex models. I mean, deep learning, you would have models with like millions of parameters whose values, those weights that you're trying to learn and so on. And the problem with, so while they work quite well in the, I mean, for most of the cases, there are huge problems with the kind of models that we build. Most of the times, these models are not very generalizable because you start subjecting them to very different kind of data than what you had trained on, and these models stop working. There are other issues. So I feel there's a, so while this aspect of using learning to help with scientific discovery, right, the fourth paradigm, has received and continues to receive a fair amount of and growing attention, I believe we also need to pay attention to this part. And hopefully, science is where maybe we can learn from the scientists in how to build these compact models, which are more generalizable, which are more robust than today's deep learning models. So one of the things that we do at Google Research, again, this is a slide I picked up from Jeff Dean. So what Google Research really kind of encourages researchers to do is to be ambitious. Actually, not just researchers. I mean, in general, that's a part of the ethos of the company. And one of the ways in which we try to kind of do some sanity check, are we working on ambitious enough problems, is to see, to look at things like this. So in 2008, the US National Academy of Engineering came out with a list of what they considered the grand engineering challenges for the next century, for the 21st century. And the ones color-coded here in red are those areas where there is some activity at Google Research, specifically on actually applying deep learning to help make a difference to this particular problem. So already you see, again, a fair number of engineering and scientific kind of problems where deep learning is being applied. At Google, it has almost, I mean, artificial intelligence has almost become synonymous with machine learning, although we know, I mean, machine learning is a subset of AI. And then deep learning has almost become synonymous with machine learning. So I'll start with the first example of predicting properties of molecules, which becomes very important for things like drug discovery as well as advanced material design. So the standard, again, with the third leg of scientific discovery, right, numerical simulations, what computational chemists are often doing is applying essentially something like Schrodinger's equations. So there are now approximations to Schrodinger's equations in the form of this density functional theory simulator. And when you apply something like this, again, the computational requirements are so high that usually you're only able to deal with relatively small molecules. You're not able to deal with very, very large complex systems. So there are various benchmarks, like there's this QM9 benchmark where given these whatever molecules, you have to predict 13 properties of those molecules. In case of, let's say, drug design, right? You're very interested in properties like will it bind with a given protein and so on. So what do computer scientists do, right, when they are dealing with any such problem? Computer scientists love using graphs. So here, graphs seem like kind of a natural way to model this, because molecules, you represent atoms as nodes, look at atoms as nodes in your graph. The bonds between those atoms become the edges in the graph. So this team at Google Research, again, I'm relatively new to Google, so again, I'll be really presenting a lot of the work by other colleagues, and actually not just, I'll also present some work that's been done outside Google. So my colleagues came up with this at Google Research, came up with this message passing neural net architecture, which had, which was operating over these graphs corresponding to molecules, a graphical graph-based representation of molecules. One very important characteristic of this particular model that they built was that it could deal with these symmetries in the graphs and recognize their equivalence quite naturally. This is analogous to all these convolutional networks, neural networks, when they do image recognition. They're able to deal with a lot of symmetries very easily, right? I mean, if it's a dog, if you rotate that dog, if you just move it from one part of the image to another, these CNN techniques will still work because they are able to deal with a lot of these symmetrical situations, various transformations that you might do as equivalent. So this message passing neural network had similar properties, that a lot of these symmetrical things in the graph, right, which you might think of as like isomorphism in the graph, it was able to very naturally represent as your representation was invariant to all these symmetries, and with the result that it was computationally significantly more efficient than using this density functional theory simulator, so by close to a factor of 300,000 times. So with this, they were able to build, again, do predictions of some of these, again, properties of these molecules. They looked at this particular benchmark, the QM9 benchmark, and they were able to, again, come up with state-of-the-art results in terms of predicting 11 out of those 13 properties, but computationally much faster, something like factor of 300,000 times faster. Again, this work was reported in ICML 2017 conference. So now let me turn closer to India. So I'll talk about, again, two pieces of work that I particularly feel have special significance for India, and in fact, they have been done. There's a fair amount of that work that has been done in the Indian context. So flood prediction flooding is, by the way, a global phenomenon. And there's a significant effort at Google Research overall in studying climate change, global warming, and also in understanding how can we mitigate the effect of global warming. So including at our lab, again, we have this focus on agriculture. One of the groups which is applying all these computer vision techniques to satellite imaging. And the goal is to be able to come up with ways of, for instance, automatically identifying soil moisture, crop types, and so on, and eventually help reduce the amount of water that gets consumed for agriculture. This is part of an effort where we are also trying to figure out how can we apply, again, machine learning to help mitigate the impact of climate change, because already flooding, if you look at, I mean, this doesn't happen every year, but if you look at a multi-year history, on an average, floods are affecting 250 million people annually. On an average, they are leading to so many fatalities and close to $10 billion in economic damage on an average. And with global warming, these numbers are expected to become worse. So Google has, again, an effort, initiative for scalable, high accuracy, high resolution flood forecasts and warnings globally. And the initial focus is on riverine floods. A significant part of that work has been done on the Ganga River. And this, by the way, has been done, this has been led by our colleagues from Israel. But we have now have, as we build up our team in India, we have our researchers who are beginning to contribute to some aspects of this research. So in a nutshell, essentially what you do is you start with physical measurements of these water levels. So we have a partnership with Central Water Commission, with the government of India. They give us these water gauge readings at different points that they take. And from that, again, what we are doing is we are building these hydrologic and hydraulic models through which we are doing the predictions and then sending early warnings. So, So our job is primarily, so this is what we get from the government of India in this, in the case of the data of this effort in India. And this is our job, to build these hydrologic models and hydraulic models. So at a high level, a hydrologic model is given the temperature, precipitation, and so on, some of these factors, you have to come up with the estimation of the level of water in the river at different points in time. So this is, think of it as a time series prediction problem. So here we actually, and the traditional way is you build, you have these different components in a hydrologic model, which are again built using physics-based, again, laws of physics-based numerical simulations. So here what we did in applying, again, machine learning, we actually, okay, so this part I should clarify is not work. This was an academic work that was done. I'm forgetting the name of the researchers at a European university. So they showed that if you use this LSTM architecture, right, that many of you may be familiar with, long short-term memory, and you feed it those inputs. So the inputs are those usual temperature, precipitation parameters. The output is that water level at different points. And again, this is done as a time series problem. The beauty of deep learning architectures, right, generally has been that you haven't had the need to do feature engineering. You just give it these input parameters, input data, and the model, the deep learning network model is able to automatically infer the kind of, I should say, within quotes, right, so to speak, model, because it still has a lot of issues that I'll again talk about again. Where it is able to automatically infer the model. And LSTM architecture in particular has some advantages because LSTM allows you to remember things, the impact of data from kind of earlier times. And what happens in the real world is the rainfall from, in fact, even a week ago can have a bearing on the level of your water in the river at a given point in point in space, and it could be impacted by a rain event that happened a week earlier. So this LSTM architecture in particular allows you to very naturally model those kinds of long-term effects that rain has. So with this, they found that they were able to get fairly accurate kind of predictions. Not only that, the other very interesting phenomenon that they observed was when they looked at the hidden layers of these LSTM, they found that these hidden layers were very nicely kind of capturing certain known phenomenon like these snow water equivalent, known concepts in traditional hydrologic models. They were getting captured very nicely by these hidden layers. So that was, again, very interesting to see that somehow the deep learning network seemed to be learning some important characteristics of this model. For the hydraulic model, essentially what you have to do is, yeah, given this whatever flow of water, you have to now infer what it will do to the region surrounding the river, right, to the plain. And so some of the challenges that you have before you start applying the hydraulic model, what you need is, again, this digital elevation maps. So that is very important kind of data that you need as input to these hydraulic models. And that itself is a non-trivial problem I'll just talk about. The other part, of course, you need is, again, you need those water gauge measurements and forecasts of those measurements. And again, our job, again, is to, again, build this hydraulic model. But before we get to the hydraulic model, let me just talk a little bit about some of the challenges associated with building these digital elevation maps. So today, the current gold standard, or whatever, I mean, yesterday's gold standard was this thing called SRTM, which is, again, the prior to applying machine learning, the kind of state of the art. And SRTM data would be was considered the gold standard, and it was only available at 90 meter by 90 meter resolution. So what happens is that if you start with that data and you're kind of modeling the flow of, again, as the water flows, and again, here this simulation has been speeded up, you try to model, okay, what's going to be the impact of all this water rushing down the river bed. With this resolution that you get out of SRTM, you get these results. Whereas with what our researchers showed, that once you get finer grain data, once you build these finer grain digital elevation maps, you were able to now get much more accurate kind of predictions about what's going to happen, right, in terms of the where the water would land. The other issue with these elevation maps is that, again, this SRTM data, it tends to be kind of there, kind of frozen in time. So SRTM data is actually roughly 20 years old. And what happens in the real world is rivers, they change their course, especially after floods. They will do some kind of, there will be some kind of a change in the course of the river. So what you get from the SRTM data is now outdated. So, and this is, by the way, one area where, again, one of our researchers, Varun Gulshan, he is now applying his computer vision techniques to satellite images to see if you can automatically identify those changes in the river flow. But where that has been done, the way it has been, the problem has been attacked in the existing piece of work is in basically applying techniques analogous to stereography, right, where you try to infer the depth from these stereo cameras. You're essentially trying to get those digital elevation maps, build them computationally. The next thing after you build those digital elevation maps, the next thing you need to do is to build what is known as the digital terrain model. Because when you're trying to, when you're interested in kind of flood modeling and so on, you have to in some sense ignore any of those structures which are not going to block the flow of the water, you really need to ignore. So the only thing that matters are those structures which are actually blocking the flow of the water. So now to build these digital terrain models, again, our researchers use this deep neural network and were able to, again, get reasonably precise digital terrain models where, again, these network automatically learned some of these. So now, armed with now this digital terrain model and now with this input gauge data that we were getting essentially from the government. So again, this is a global effort. A fair amount of that has actually been done in India together with CWC. And as we got this, so again, a very simplified picture of this hydraulic model. Conceptually, just like in your high school or whatever, physics class, right? You would have learned about the, let's say, a ball rolling down the slope, and there are different forces. There is the force of gravity, there is the force of friction, which is kind of acting in that direction and so on, and you're kind of predicting the actual motion of the ball. Conceptually, there's a very similar thing which is being done by these hydraulic model. That think of this as water that is flowing down the river, because river is moving from a higher elevation to a lower elevation. So there is that force of gravity. There are likewise forces of friction. And as you start forming these equations, you get something like this. And then, so what our team did was, again, they implemented a hydraulic model based on convolutional neural networks. And the way they trained these networks were with the these equations, which are known as Saint-Venant's equations. These were used to train the network. So we used the equations to train the network, and then we used whatever the network model it kind of learned as the whatever as the model on the actual data. And with that, and again, I mean, there were other challenges of computational costs, which were, again, dealt with using This is the kind of stuff I used to do, domain decomposition and high performance computing and so on, because this was still computationally fairly intensive. And especially here, what we wanted to do was go to much finer resolution, right? So remember, I was showing the traditional models have been applied at a resolution of 90 meter by 90 meter. We wanted to go to a resolution of 1 meter by 1 meter. And this is kind of a theme of going to high resolution. I mean, I've been dealing with that for several years, back to like Lloyd Trinish's work when he used to be, when I used to be a colleague of his at IBM Research. These guys had also come up with these very, very fine-grained weather forecast models where you could do very accurate predictions at a kind of even within a city level rather than at a very coarse grain. So as you go for these high resolution, typically your computational costs go up by, I mean, if you increase the resolution by a factor of 2, your computational costs go up by a factor of 8. So again, what we did was we applied, again, the TPUs at Google, which gave us roughly 85 times faster results than compared to the CPU. And now we were ready to do these predictions based on the input that we were getting of the water levels. And the traditional model before machine learning was used had essentially a recall of about 32%, which means it's only like there are a lot of false negatives, right, that you can see. Roughly two-thirds of the cases it is missing because of that not very high recall. And the precision was even lower. Precision was lower than 20%, so which means when it says there is flooding, five times, there would actually not be a flooding. And again, these can lead to a lot of that cry wolf kind of phenomenon, right? So people would lose faith when they see too many of these predictions which are not accurate. So the first version of the model that, again, I mean, this shows as the current model, but this was the initial version. So the team was able to come up with a recall of close to 95% and a precision of 75%. And pictorially, it is shown here. So the stuff in blue is the predictions that are in agreement with the ground truth data. And this, by the way, in case you're wondering which river am I showing this data for, this is our river Ganga. And this is, again, a particular region in Bihar where this kind of study was conducted. So again, then we used some of our standard products to make this information available to the public. So again, as we did these flood prediction through Google search, through Google Maps, and then, these are the pull-based model. Anybody who does a search on Google or looks up the Google map, we would provide those warnings. But then also using Android, there were alerts that were sent. So in fact, last year, there was, again, a repeat of this pilot, which was done. And again, this is a particular region in, I think, the state of Bihar, again, where they were able to identify these events happening. And about 1.3 million notifications were sent last year. In the work that was done last year on the river Ganga, the team was achieving a recall of roughly 95% and a precision of, I believe, roughly 90%. So fairly high precision and recall. So again, switching gears. Now let me talk about, again, this is my favorite topic. I believe the time is ripe, really, for us to kind of apply AI to disrupt healthcare. I mean, healthcare needs a complete transformation relative to the system that we have today. So if you look at healthcare spending on an annualized basis, on a per-person basis, you will find, again, some very interesting data. So United States, which often prides itself on having the most advanced healthcare system, the healthcare costs are simply out of control. For the year 2018, the US was spending, again, over $10,000 per person per annum. This is not how much you spend on your healthcare if you fall sick. This is what was being sent what was being spent if you are an average person living in an average year, not the year that you fall sick and so on. So the US kind of, certainly is in some sense an outlier, but again, they're desperately trying to figure out how to cut these costs while improving quality, because you don't want to cut costs at the expense of quality. If you compare that data with, let's say, countries like UK, which has less than half of that spend per person, many of these countries, in fact, have better life expectancy and so on. So in some sense, you could argue better outcomes compared to the US. So initial kind of, you may have you may want to just assume that, oh, it's only the US system which is kind of having issues. All that you need to do is follow the kind of systems that these countries have, and you will be fine. But if you look at the data, and apologies, this is kind of some older data that I have, but many of these trends are continuing even today. What you find is pretty much rising healthcare costs per person, which each of these countries considers unsustainable. So the only country which doesn't seem to have that problem of rapidly rising average healthcare spending increase per person is Mera Bharat Mahan, right? India. And somebody who's not familiar with India might think, oh, India is doing something right. But again, the reason this curve is so flat is because we don't provide healthcare to much of our population. So that's a very easy way to keep costs low. But again, I mean, if you look at those of us who are lucky enough to have healthcare, access to healthcare, our curves will probably look much closer to the US curve. So if we want to provide healthcare to our entire population, there's no way we can afford to take the path that other countries like the US have taken. US cannot afford its own healthcare system despite being much, much wealthier than India. There's no way India is going to afford that kind of a healthcare system. So I believe, again, technology provides a wonderful kind of basis for an answer. Again, technology will not provide the solution. And in particular in healthcare, you have to be extremely careful about how you apply technology. But this is where I believe the real answer. And as I listened to various healthcare experts, so I used to work on compilers. My PhD was in compilers for computers. And as compiler writers, we were always trying to optimize the performance of these programs. And one of the things we used to care about is optimizing for the memory hierarchy in a computer system. So for those of you who are familiar with computer systems, you know that when you're trying to improve the performance of the program, you're trying to make sure that all these data accesses, as much as possible, they happen out of registers in your CPU. If not the registers, let them happen out of the level one cache of your system. If not level one cache, level two cache, otherwise level three cache, otherwise main memory. And God forbid, you need to go to the hard disk to access that data. So what I realized as I listened to the healthcare experts is something very similar is going on in the world of healthcare. That healthcare system itself, analogous to these memory hierarchy in computer systems, is built in these tiers, where the most expensive tier is this ICU. Right, and there was a doctor who tried to illustrate it dramatically by asking the question. He asked the question at a healthcare conference, where do you find the most expensive place to stay overnight? And the initial thought that comes to everybody's mind is some fancy resort in an exotic location, maybe Hawaii or something. And he pointed to the ICU of a typical hospital. He said, this is where you have to spend, often in the US, over $10,000 to rent that bed. It's not a particularly fun place to spend your night. But this is how expensive it is. So the point he was making was that you need to try and treat people before they get to the ICU. And in fact, I would say there's an even more expensive tier beyond the ICU, right? Which is the graveyard. And actually machine learning, through predictions, you can try to have better outcomes, right? Because if somebody is already in an ICU, you can try to apply machine learning over all of this healthcare data that you have about the individual, their medical history, as well as all these measurements which are being taken, and try to predict complications before they happen and hopefully save the person's life. But the same argument can be carried all the way to earlier tiers, where ideally, when people are admitted in the hospital, in the other parts, Can you take care of them there? And can you do predictions of which patients might run into those complications that require ICU admission and take some proactive action? And the argument carries over. So I believe, my belief is that the real action in healthcare is going to be outside the hospitals. Because what you have in the name of healthcare systems today are really sick care systems, which take care of you when you fall sick. And what you need are true healthcare systems, which try and keep you healthy while you're living your normal lives, when we are at home, at work, and so on. And that's the name of the game. Again, this was work done in my previous job when we were at Xerox, and it has led to a nice startup called Nirama Analytics, where, again, they're trying to apply machine learning to analyzing these thermal images. Because what happens is, when there is a malignant tumor, there is blood vessel activity in the region to feed this growing tumor, and that shows up in the form of a thermal signature. In the past, there were too many false positives when you use this as a screening methodology. Again, the question that this startup is looking at is, can you apply now machine learning to reliably distinguish between those malignant and benign tumors? Another problem, so this is a problem where our researchers, my time is up, so I'll just take maybe two more minutes. Diabetic retinopathy, which is, again, a growing cause of blindness, and a common theme in applying machine learning to healthcare is, if you can, just like prevention is better than cure, if you can detect things in a timely manner. So regular screening is the key. In India, there's, again, a severe shortage of eye doctors. So 45% of the patients end up having a vision loss before they are diagnosed. The way the diagnosis is done is by taking this retinal fundus image and looking for signs of hemorrhage. One of the issues we faced while doing this work is that while in some cases there's fairly clear kind of ophthalmologists agree on what the actual patient state is, there are some corner cases, like if you look at this case number 5 and 13, where the ophthalmologists themselves don't agree on whether this is a case of diabetic retinopathy or not. So in this case, we actually use this adjudication process to come up with the ground truth. But essentially what we did was we took that neural network that was built to recognize, distinguish between cats and dogs. Now that neural network got a better purpose in its life than distinguishing between cats and dogs. It started looking for grading these images on this 5-point scale of no diabetic retinopathy to proliferative diabetic retinopathy. And again, I mean, the team did some fairly rigorous experiments. They published a paper in 2016 in the Journal of the American Medical Association. Very proud that this work was kind of the first author on this paper was my colleague Varun Gulshan. He's a researcher who moved to Google Research India before Google Research India existed. So, I mean, he was a researcher based in the US. He said, no, I want to be based in India. And he simply moved and started working with other colleagues. So his work with other colleagues, it was widely praised. And more recently, this was news from last week. There was some rating that the community did of the best JAMA papers in the last decade. This was one of those 10 papers that showed up on that list. And later, again, the team improved further on these results. And now they showed results that were on par with real specialists. So very, very impressive results. At the same time, I want to still strike a note of caution that while these algorithms are working extremely well, there are still significant challenges. We still do not have a real deep understanding of why are they working. And more importantly, when will these algorithms not work? What are those situations? So in particular, there is that degradation happens when the production data set is very different. People have shown adversarial attacks where you modify a few pixels, and it looks like a whatever aeroplane to a human, and the deep learning model says it's a pig. And not just that, not only does it make that mistake, it makes that mistake very confidently. So we have also seen humans, right, make all these statements very confidently. But my theory is that deep inside, I might be confidently saying a lie, but deep inside, I know that I don't know, right, when I'm just bluffing. Whereas these deep learning models, even deep inside, they don't know that they don't know. So that's a real problem. That's a real, again, there's a lot of very active research being done, including I'm engaged in some joint research with a professor from neuroscience department at IISc to see can we apply some ideas from how the human brain does it to teach the neural networks when they don't know. And I'll kind of maybe conclude with this slide. I believe just like in India, we did a leapfrogging play from landlines. There were very few landlines in India, and we simply skipped the landlines and jumped straight away to mobile phones. Right now, everybody in India and their dog have a mobile phone. So my view is, likewise, we have an opportunity. We have a need and an opportunity to do a similar leapfrogging play with our healthcare. We don't have hospitals in covering much of our population. We have a need to come up with that equivalent of no need for those sick care systems, right? So many hospitals. Can we build truly preventive and wellness-based systems, starting with creating a personalized health record for an individual? Because today, health records are all very provider-centric. Hospitals have them, but we should create that for a consumer, and it has to be done in a privacy, any kind of analysis on that ideally should be done in a privacy-preserving manner, because healthcare data is very sensitive. So while I need to build models that learn from each and every one of you, all of your data, but I should not be able to trace the data, track it back to the individual data for any of you when I build those models. So can you do those in a privacy-preserving manner? Again, and there's a lot of work being done at Google Research on federated learning techniques to build those models in that manner. And can you then provide timely interventions for things like lifestyle changes, medical consultation, well ahead of me having a heart attack? Can the system suggest to me both lifestyle modification, look, you need to exercise more, you need to eat better, and so on, as well as, look, now you need to go and consult a cardiologist because things are getting bad. So we want to build such predictive systems, focusing initially maybe on either the cardiovascular disease or diabetes, but really do this as a platform play so that later different providers can plug in their own disease models. So let me stop here. I apologize for taking too much time. But I think, again, we have kind of an amazing opportunity to start to apply all of this computing power at our disposal for many of these problems that are all around us and really make a transformational difference to many of these problems. So I think the future is extremely bright for technologists. And again, I look forward to many innovations coming out of people sitting in this audience today. Thank you.
Any questions?
Thank you, Dr. Gupta, for an exciting talk here. So I have a question here.
Yeah.
So when you spoke about these complex diseases like neurodegenerative or cancer, they involve activation and inhibition of multiple molecules. And most of the time when we talk about coding of these signatures in form of models to go for precision medicine and all, these interactions and output varies from patient to patient. So this is like another real challenge. How do we code them and bring a model to predict right drug, right disease, right treatments? Can you comment on that?
Yeah, so that's a very important point. So in fact, there have been even before all of this machine learning was applied and so on, people have shown that sometimes we have a tendency to treat this whatever cancer as, okay, cancer, and come up with a generic drug that will help everybody affected with that form of cancer. And often that doesn't work. And there have been drugs, was it Herceptin, which was a drug for breast cancer. Again, as they started doing trials, they realized it was not effective for much of the population. Then they realized that if there were for women who had a particular kind of gene, it was extremely effective for those women. It was not effective for others. So I think, again, there is a need for us to start to develop those kinds of personalized treatment models. And I would think that the traditional techniques are very hard to scale, right, to the level of an individual. This is where, again, machine learning and all of this power of analysis of data can help us get to these kinds of models, which are even personalized to the genome of a given individual. So I think that's very promising. It's also fair to say that many of these promises, I mean, they have been very exciting possibilities for a long time now, but it has taken us a long time, right, to realize those promises. So there are still many, many outstanding challenges. I mean, I don't want to minimize and say, oh, this is like a problem, I mean, which is going to be solved in the next few years, right? That just throw that data and learn a deep learning model and you'll come out with a solution. But yes, these approaches present a very promising approach to dealing with this problem that you just outlined.
Yeah. Of course, I'll talk a lot more about the personalized medicine aspect in the afternoon. But I wanted to bring up on the disaster management. You talked about the hydraulic model. But on seismic, actually, it has turned out that deep learning is really not effective. And in fact, straight linear regression does as well as deep learning. So is there a lesson there? Are there some problems for which deep learning works and others for which?
Yeah, so again, in my view, it's still, that's part of what is interesting today about research in this space, that these techniques are being very effective for certain problems, and we don't really understand deeply why they are being effective, right? Because at a conceptual level, it's the same whatever optimization approach which is being applied. So, and it's not just like seismic versus this hydrologic model. Sometimes what you find is even, let's say, in machine translation, I mean, earlier people showed that a certain deep learning model would work very well for a certain pair of languages, but then it would not work for a different pair of languages, and they couldn't understand why. So over there have been several advances. So more recently, again, through these things like BERT and so on, they have shown, again, transfer learning being very, very effective, where you essentially do some kind of a pre-learning over a very, very large corpus, and then you try to learn a specific model through transfer learning for your specific context. So in the natural language processing models in the world, somehow the community has been able to make fairly significant progress. I think there are many areas where we are still very far away. And that is what I think makes research in this area so interesting, because we still don't know why it's working, and we don't know when it doesn't work.
I have a question.
Yeah.
Very interesting talk, thank you. You said that Google has shaken hands with the Central Water Commission for flood-related data that goes back into your model. I talked to some of my climate friends who do turbulence model simulation. They keep saying that subgrid scale modeling, why it doesn't work for India, for example. If you go to Switzerland, the whole economy is based on climate prediction. You can do it by minute by minute prediction, and they have much more structural complex stuff. Whereas in India, yeah, we have also a lot of structural problem. The main thing people say is that we don't get ground data inputs for models for turbulence. Now, if Google can shake hands, Google India, for example, shake hands with, I don't know what is the government thing for it, for improving the number of input data to the models,
sure.
I think that would phenomenally improve, and it's one of our biggest problems, I mean,
sure.
Climate forecast.
Yeah, so
Is there any work on this kind of thing that you...
So far this work was being led out of the folks who are in Israel, but they have been visiting India and kind of doing a fair, because this was, overall the effort was very global in nature, but they found India to be a very fertile ground, right, for actively then really testing out these ideas and showing whether they work. I'm happy to follow up with you and see, because as we start to have our own researchers working on these kind of problems, we are very interested in collaborations where we can collaborate with the scientific community here because there are still many, many outstanding challenges in all of this. Because here I didn't talk about some of those challenges. I mean, even to scale these efforts and so on, there's a lot of new work that needs to be done.
Sir, can you please comment on explaining that how much we have achieved already and what we can expect when it gets saturated?
Yeah, so explainability of, in particular, these deep learning models is still a very, very active area of research, because for the most part, I mean, what you get is, again, amazing accuracy, but for the most part, you do not really fully understand what is it that the model, I mean, why is the model working and how is it working? So what has been done so far is, for instance, in computer vision community, right, where deep learning was very successful, they have shown that, yes, some of these lower level layers, they are learning the low level features of a line, a curve, and so on. And then higher level layers are learning some of the higher level features, right, that my face would have these kinds of eyes and this kind of a mouth and so on. So there is some understanding. And likewise, there are other researchers. So a lot of that work has so far been kind of focused on computer vision because people are able to visualize things more conveniently. I would say it is still very far from satisfactory in terms of, because often people are coming up with post-facto explanations. This is how the model probably learned. Whereas if you could come up with kind of much more accurate kind of explainable models, I believe, I mean, that because another issue that we have is sometimes when people try to build explainable models, the level of accuracy actually goes down today with current techniques. In my view, ideally, right, explainable models ought to be more robust and ought to be kind of more generalizable and so on, right, and work better, which we are still not at that point. So again, this is just an area. I mean, offline, I can tell you specific examples, right? So I mean, for instance, in these classification problems, see, a lot of, so one area where there's a lot of interest in explainability is when you are using machine learning, when you are making certain recommendations, let's say loan processing. You're trying to decide, should this person get a loan or not? Or should this person be released on bail or not? So what some of my colleagues have done recently is, and previously these models were complete black boxes. There was no way you could do any explanation for why you have recommended that this person be given a loan. So some new work that has been done on explainability was, even if you are unable to explain why the model said, can you at least come up with some actionable things that if your income, where you choose certain parameters, it could be, let's say, your level of income, it could be maybe another parameter, where in terms of those two variables, where you say that if you were not chosen for the high class, right, that if you were denied a loan or if you were denied a bail application, in terms of those two parameters, can the system automatically tell you, had your income been whatever at this level or higher, or had your past repayment been at this level or whatever better and so on, you would have been given the loan. So in specific situations, again, even though the original algorithm is not very explainable, can you provide this level of explanation which would matter to the individual who's affected by that decision, right? And there they made again the simplifying assumption that if you were given a loan, you would not be interested in an explanation, right? Then you're happy that I've been given a loan. It's only when you're denied a loan that you want an explanation. So when you work on simpler versions of this problem, they were able to make some progress. But again, this is a very active area of research.
I have a very naive question. In the sense that, you know, you're a computer specialist. I'm a non-computer specialist, but you're applying AI techniques for identifying unknown material, right? It is true that we can use this and get like close to 98-99% accuracy. My student will give a talk in the afternoon. What is shocking to me, when we do simulations, in order to confirm whether our work is correct or not, we actually check whether the simulation is working or not by feeding the wrong information and get the wrong data and confirm that we know what we're doing is correct or not. But why are people not doing that in deep learning? I mean, can we not feed a completely offline data into the set of, say, 50, 100 data, and say 20% of them are not classified into this, and then see what the result is? Are people not doing anything like that?
I think, I mean, people are applying often, again, these simulations to feed, in fact, train the neural network and so on, and then using whatever ground truth data you have from the real world experiments to then do the evaluation of these techniques in a different setting, because it doesn't help to do the testing on the same data, right, where you have trained, because that would be like cheating. So, I mean, people are doing that validation. And I mean, in a way, what was almost like, I mean, I used to be honestly not a believer in this. I mean, I used to think of this machine learning based science, at least many years ago, as pseudoscience, that, oh, they are going away from the laws of physics and so on, and kind of trying to almost like, it felt like astrology and so on to me, which is why I was very interested in hearing what Jayant has to say.
Jayant, to say.
But what I've seen is, again, I mean, these people are not just building these models in a vacuum. They are usually applying a lot of logic. They are trying to come up with models that will have some kind of bearing on some properties of that system. But at a deeper level, why is that model working? That people still don't know.
That's what shocked me when we tried it. We couldn't believe it.
So what shocked me was, I mean, I worked on this machine called BlueGene, where the driving application was to understand the mechanism of protein folding, right? So the idea behind BlueGene was to somehow use the usual equations, right? Laws of motion and so on, to do ab initio simulation, right? Of how these protein molecules are finally kind of folding. And what was shocking to me was, again, I mean, I shouldn't be say shocking, what was surprising to me was last year, that contest, that CASP contest on protein structure prediction was won by the DeepMind team at Alphabet, applying deep learning based techniques for protein structure prediction. So somehow these models are learning something that we still have not been able to abstract out as humans, and getting better performance than any of these physics, whatever, biology based models.
Sounds dangerous to
yeah,
me. But
yeah. Yeah, yeah.
But they even beat the B.E. Shaw's machine, right?
Yeah.
Good. Thank you, Manish. Thank you very much. Please join me in thanking Manish for all the support.